side project I started up as part of my hobby in doing panoramic photography. And I was interested in learning how to implement code and get it to run on the graphics processor as a way of speeding up the computation. So this project is focused on doing that. Okay, so what does Nona do? Nona is one of these back-end tools that is doing all the heavy math in the panoramic creation process. So it is taking pictures that you take with your camera and applying transformations to them to get them to all line up with each other. And it's specifically, you have to give it the recipe for what kind of transformation you want to do. You use the Huggin tool to line up your images, it produces that recipe, and then Nona applies the transform to the images. So it does all the math to do this sort of conversion here. Okay. So the process that we want to do is we want to speed this up. We want to get this to run on the graphics card instead of on the CPU. So what kind of math do you have to do? So the general idea in panoramic photography is that you have your camera is at some point in space, and you're going to rotate it around that point and take a whole bunch of pictures and stitch them together. So the field of view of the camera is the solid angle in space. That's what you can see. And that corresponds to some patch of surface area on this virtual sphere that you're at the center of. And so you can imagine that there's a mapping between the pixels in your camera and spots on the surface of the sphere. And then you're going to use some standard mapmaker's projection to flatten this guy out and turn it into a print or a graphic that you can display on your monitor. So the things you need to know in order to do this transform, you need to know what is the orientation of the camera for each of the pictures. It's yaw, pitch, and roll in space. And you need to know some stuff about what kind of camera you're using. What type of lens do you have? Do you have a fisheye or a rectilinear lens or something like that? What's the field of view? That's kind of how much surface area on the sphere do I cover with each picture I take? And any kind of lens distortions that the camera has, like barrel distortion, things like that. And then finally, you want to know what kind of projection you're going to use. You can make a rectilinear output like this, or you can project back to another fisheye projection. You can basically do anything you want, really. And the tool is also going to do a couple extra things for us. It's going to take care of any vignetting that was in the camera so that you can make sure it's really easy for the seams to disappear when you use N-Blend later to merge all the images together. It'll take care of stuff like the minor exposure differences and stuff like color balance between the images that you take. So all of these steps can kind of be summed up in three parts when you actually start doing the math. So the first part, you need to do a coordinate transform. So this is all of your mapping from a pixel in the output image, some coordinate in the output image, back to some coordinate in the input image. And this is all like ancient Greek trigonometry and stuff like that, 2,000 years old. Lots of sines and cosines and things. Okay, the second part, you need to do some interpolation. Once you figure out where you are in the source image, it's going to give you some coordinate with some fractional value on it. And there's not going to be a pixel exactly at that spot in the input image. It's going to be somewhere between pixels. And so you need to have a visually appealing interpolation approach to figure out what value the output should be at this fractional coordinate. And so typically what that involves is that you put down a filter of some sort. However complex of a filter you want, you sample a bunch of pixels from around the neighborhood of the spot that you want, and then you take a carefully constructed weighted average of those to figure out what the output value should be. And finally, the third part is you apply some photometric adjustment to the value that you interpolate back. So one of those for doing the vignetting correction is a function of the radius of how far away you are from the center of the image there. And so I exaggerated it for this picture. You can imagine your camera suffers from some vignetting, and you want to adjust the luminance of the output pixels by some function of the radius. In this example here, there's another kind of correction you can do for white balance. This is kind of a purpley red kind of image here. And so we're going to adjust the ratio of the red and the blue by some coefficient, which will help correct that problem there. Okay, so you just combine all those three steps together. You get a basic algorithm for what you need to do this remapping. You do, for each pixel in the output, you do the coordinate transform, gets you the source image pixel coordinates, fetch that using the interpolator, apply some adjustments to it, and then write that out to the output image. And now if you want a gigapixel panorama, you just do this 1 billion times, and then you're all set. So of course, if you have to do it 1 billion times, you want it to be kind of efficient. So that's where this project comes in, is to try to solve that. So the NOMA tools that exist today will already do multi-threading. So if you have a quad-core processor, it'll do, you know, 4 output image pixels in parallel, since all of these are completely independent iterations of this loop. This is one of those things they call a trivially parallelizable algorithm. So where NOMA GPU comes in is we want to use the graphics processor to do this, because for a relatively small number of dollars, you can get lots of extra cores which are capable of doing this processing for you. So here's just kind of an example of something that's a high-end NVIDIA card, how much money you can spend and how many cores you get. And fortunately, NOMA GPU will give you a good speed up even if you don't have that much money. If you have a low-end card from either of these manufacturers, you can get one for a fairly cheap amount, and it still gives you a substantial improvement in performance for this here. So not only does it have a bunch of programmable processors on it that will do this computation for you, it also has the ability to process RGBA data directly as a native format using a SIMD-style data path on those processors. Okay, so a little bit about what OpenGL is going to do for us. We're going to turn this panoramic image processing application into an OpenGL application and write ourselves a program which is going to run on the graphics card to do the math. So in OpenGL, what you have is you draw a bunch of polygons in 3D space, and you set up your camera somewhere, and you set up your screen plane somewhere, and what it will do for you is it figures out how your polygons project onto the screen plane, and then it will color them in. So that part is the rasterization step. So this is where these are your pixels on your output on your screen plane, and here's your transformed polygon, and it's going to basically go through here and color those in. And so there's a couple different ways you can decide how to color these. You can just say, I want the triangle to be blue, or you can do something a little more complicated. You can say, I want to texture map it. So here I've assigned a texture coordinate to each of these vertices, and that corresponds to some location in this input texture, and it will figure out for all these intermediate points inside the triangle where it needs to fetch the source data from in that texture. So this is something also that's kind of built into OpenGL. And the next newest thing you can do, which is the cool part where NOMA GPU comes in, is you can kind of write your own program that the graphics card will run to calculate the color of all these points inside this polygon. And so this is called writing a fragment shader. And this little program here will be in some language that you can use, like the one I use for this project is the GL shading language, or GLSL, which is basically compatible between both NVIDIA and ATI. So I can use the same executable and have it run on either graphics card without having to jump through no more than a couple hoops to get that to work. But otherwise, it's fairly good. So essentially what I'm going to do is I'm just going to take my pseudocode algorithm here, and I'll spare you the details of the syntax and all the exact thing that goes on there. And I plug that in and turn that into a fragment shader. And so it's going to run my panoramic transform in order to fill in the values of this output image. Okay, so this is kind of how you can formulate this problem. You'll set up this input as a texture, you give that to the graphics card and tell it this is the texture you're going to be sampling from. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to tell the graphics card to draw one rectangle, which is the same size as the output image I want. And I'll set up an orthographic projection such that there's an exact one-to-one mapping between pixels on my screen plane and the size of this output rectangle. And what that means is the graphics card is going to, for each pixel in the output image I want, it's going to fill in exactly one iteration of my fragment shader program. And it will do all of these in parallel. So effectively, it's going to draw the output. Each pixel in the output, it runs through this loop for you, and then does sampling from this input texture in order to fill it in. That's basically all there is to it. When people talk about doing general purpose computation on GPUs, this is what they mean. They have an application where they effectively have a matrix, and they want to compute all the values of this matrix in parallel using some algorithm and some number, one or more input matrices to that program, and it runs it in the context of rendering a rectangle. Okay, so some of the interesting pitfalls that you run into when you attempt to do this. Why is this not just so easy? Why does it take a lot of effort to get it to work right? So one major problem you have to deal with is the fact that the the graphics card has a limited size buffer to let you render to. So I think some of the new ones are like 4096 or maybe even larger than that now. Or if you're not limited by the size of the buffer, you'll still be limited by the amount of memory that's on the graphics processor. So in this case, I have, I guess this is a 24 megapixel output image that I want to create. And there's four channels RGBA, and the data format it uses is FLIP32s. So this is a fairly large chunk of memory that you need. It's not unmanageable yet, but you can see this, the images get a little bit bigger. It starts to get pretty large. And also, already one of the dimensions of this image exceeds the maximum size that you can have. So there needs to be a technique for handling this. Fortunately, this pitfall is fairly easy to overcome. We've noticed already that all of the output image pixels can all be rendered in parallel. So what you can do is you can just break this up into chunks and then render each one separately. So I'll do this in a couple passes. I'll say, first render this corner of the output, and then this corner of the output, and then this corner, and then this corner, and make each one of these smaller so that it fits inside the max buffer size that I can have. Okay, second pitfall that you run into is the source image is too big to fit in one of these buffers. This one gets a little bit more complicated now because we don't have the property anymore that we can just render a corner of the image once because we don't have all the data that we need in memory to do it anymore if you load it just a subset of the source image. Okay, so here's your, you break this into chunks here, you have the source, only this part is available, but you want to render this output chunk. You know, say if I have, if I want to sample from this, if I want to render this output pixel, then I need to sample from this box up here. That one works great. And now if I want to draw this output pixel over here, it needs to sample from some data I don't have loaded. And so you're kind of stuck. So the technique for solving this is to do another round of multi-pass rendering. And so the idea is that you're going to have an outer loop where you render all the output chunks, and for each output chunk, you're going to get to visit all of the source chunks one at a time. And the idea is that this output buffer you're going to have here is going to have partial results in it from time to time. So what I've done is you set up OpenGL to say that this source texture has a transparent border around it. So whenever someone tries to sample a pixel which is outside of this image, it's going to return back something with alpha zero. And so the interpolator will merrily go along, and it gets to here, and it starts reading values from over here, and it gets back all zeros. And so the result that you accumulate in your output starts to fade off to black, or alpha to zero, as you move outside of the boundary of the image that you have. And so the next pass, we'll move this data over here, and what we're going to do is we're going to take the partial sum we had from the previous rendering pass and add that to the samples we take from here and put that in the result. And you can see that as you go through all of the input chunks, eventually the interpolator will get to see every pixel that it wants to see exactly one time and add that up and put that in this output buffer. So you get the correct result. It just takes a little bit extra time to get it. And in order to save space and time on the graphics card, we use these ping pong buffers to do this. Basically, what this means is that you have two outputs that you use, and each time you swap to a new input chunk, you're going to reverse these two guys. You're going to make this one the new source and this one the new destination, and then you overwrite the old results, and you just bounce back and forth between those two buffers. Okay, pitfall number three. You get to the interpolation phase, and you run into yet another problem with the complexity of the program you have exceeding what you can actually run on the graphics card. So here you can imagine there's a bunch of really complicated interpolators available with PanoTools, and we want to be able to implement those. So if you have something like Spline64, it actually wants to do a 64-tap 2D filter in order to sample in the interpolator phase. And the graphics card will have a limited number of texture lookups it'll let you do per rendering pass. And it's doing this so that it can have a good balance between the amount of computation you need to do and the amount of memory bandwidth that's available to all the fragment shader processors. And so the solution for doing this is to, multi-pass rendering again, add yet another level of depth to this loop here. And basically what we'll do is we will say on the first pass we'll only sample from this quadrant of the filter, and the next pass will only sample from this quadrant to the filter, and then this pass, this quadrant, and so forth. And so this is another level of having to use those ping pong buffers again, go back and forth between the two buffers, and eventually, once you go through all the passes, everyone's seen all the pixels they want one time, you get the correct result, and everything is good. All right, pitfall number four, getting the data back. This is the tough one that I don't have a great answer for yet. So I have a 6-megapixel camera, I have a 2.4 gigahertz Pentium. If I run my images through on that computer, it takes about 10 seconds to do one of these remapping operations to render one of these things on the CPU, single core. If I do this on my graphics card, which was kindly donated by ATI for the purposes of fostering experimentation with general purpose GPU programming, and yet it is a quite old graphics card. This runs in just a couple hundred milliseconds. But getting the data back from the graphics processor back into the system memory is incredibly slow. It takes it a full 3 seconds to move that data back, which is much slower than the specification would lead you to believe that it should take. So there is something wrong. I don't know exactly what it is. You think that's completely normal? You don't think it is a driver problem?
No.
I have an AGP.
GPUs is always slow.
It's always slow. It can't be sped up. So
no,
I
done it yet.
Okay.
Please. Yeah, so one of the general rules we talk about when writing OpenGL or xDrivers is whatever you do, avoid reading back from the GPU.
Mm-hmm.
With the new GEM architecture in Intel, we're up to about 30 megabytes per second of read back from the GPU, and I was really excited when I got that, because before that, the highest I'd ever seen was about 15 megabytes per second.
Okay.
So 3 seconds to pull 6 megapixels back, that's pretty believable.
That's a heartbreaker. I was hoping that, you know, if I suddenly upgrade to a better computer and has PCI Express on it, maybe this problem would go away.
Could you actually chunk it as you finish each section, send that out while you're doing the rest?
Yes. But the
okay, so there is one trick.
Okay, tell me, yes.
You could, if you're chunking your output, you could at least stream that 50 megabytes a second so that you're not waiting for it all to happen.
Uh-huh.
So you can use pixel buffer objects, mm-hmm. which look like vertex buffer objects or FBOs that you're familiar with, sort of. And so you set that up, you ask the GPU to do GL read pixels from your output buffer into that pixel buffer object. And then hopefully, when you later come and map that pixel buffer object after you've done mm-hmm. all of your rendering, all the rest of your chunks, then hopefully at that point it'll be fast.
Yeah.
It also might not be.
I looked into this approach as well. This is effectively, you're talking about basically pipelining the operation where you're going to let the graphics card keep drawing while you stream out in parallel the results from the previous drawing step. And I have problems with this. One is that I'm basically using almost all of the graphics card memory as is just to do each rendering step. And so having enough memory available to start a second rendering step while the first one is busy streaming out is a bit of a problem.
Given that you've got lots of processing power on the graphics card and the flow at a fast back, and depending on how lossless you want your final image,
mm-hmm.
It seems to be a really good application for some compression.
Yeah. Okay. So I would like to have some more accurate numbers for you. Unfortunately, one of the, I guess the fifth pitfall, which I don't have a slide for, is keeping all of this stuff running from machine to machine and reinstalling software and whatnot. So actually, I unfortunately have not even been able to run my own tool in the last 2 months or so after upgrading to a new Ubuntu and also to a new version of the ATI drivers, which is a little sad that I haven't been able to get that running again. But that's yet another pitfall. I guess pitfall number six would be there are some minor differences in how the graphics cards do arithmetic. I found out after a great amount of manual experimentation that the arctangent operation on ATI does not work the same way as the arctangent operation on NVIDIA. It has a smaller domain. And if you go outside of the domain, it becomes inaccurate, but not very inaccurate, just a little inaccurate, but enough to be noticeable in the final output. So don't do that.
So the GPU operations for sine, cosine, arctangent, all these things are generally actually implemented as a series of GPU operations that are approximating.
Okay.
So they're not using actual hardware lookup tables or anything. So if you have strict requirements on what you want out of your sine, cosine, mm-hmm. tangent, arctangent, whatever, you might just try rolling your own, because at least you'll get more reliable results.
Okay. I think the accuracy is not too much of a concern. It just, as long as there isn't a discontinuity anywhere in the function, is more important. And unfortunately, the discontinuity will lead to artifacts in this. And it was hard to find, too. Figure out which of the functions was the one that was causing the problems.
Yeah, if you're concerned more about consistency and less about accuracy, you can use texture lookups for all those kind of things.
Yeah.
Tangent, cosine, that kind of thing. Just write the texture with your computed value and then use your input as texture lookups.
Yeah, but that works.
Another thing that I was going to ask is in your loop and loop and loop, whatever, you can also use the, I don't know if you do that already, use the minimum and maximum texture coordinates of your polygon to call the input. For example, if your destination, you basically have a polygon there with texture coordinates in the four corners, then you know that one source corner is not going to be usable. You can just call that loop and then not use any of the other ones.
Yeah. In the example I showed, the transform is not too complicated. If you have a more complicated panoramic projection, like if you're doing an equal rectangular image or something and you have a shot near the zenith, it's going to be extremely distorted. And
yeah.
So it can be quite complicated to figure out which source chunks you need to render each destination chunk. And so I currently don't make any effort at doing that. And I think that the amount of time I would save by going through that is not too great.
Another thing I'm not sure if you're doing, when you're cutting benchmark like that, you have to run your iteration like many, many, many times.
Yes.
To get, all right.
Yes.
So
these are made up numbers, I admit, but this is roughly what I recall it being when from the time that I can actually run it.
All right. Yeah. And another thing, I don't know if it's true anymore, but maybe our Intel friend Ben Derek can confirm. I think it was 3 years ago when using CUDA on NVIDIA, their upload and download speed was faster than the one that you could get using OpenGL. They were similar, actually. Like you were saying, upload is usually slower, download is usually slower than upload, whereas when we were using CUDA, you had the same speed up and down, or approximately. So is it still, does anyone know if it's still the case right now, or?
It seemed to me when I was experimenting with the NVIDIA hardware, I didn't notice any severe slowdown in getting data back. It seemed to be pretty snappy. And the ATI seems much slower than NVIDIA for some reason. Okay. I would hope that it would be faster, because at the time it takes now, you're starting to lose ground against a simple quad-core machine. And so that's going to hurt everyone who wants to do GPU computation. So that's something that they got to get fixed. All right, any other questions? Anyone have more advice? Because I don't really have all the answers. All right, thank you. Oh, one more.
You mentioned that the ATI can't use donated by ATI because they wanted to do research on sort of non-traditional uses of GPUs. Do you think that those companies in general see that as a sort of value add? It's like, you can also do this, but we don't really want to put any development in it. Or do they see it as the actual future that we, you know, if they get this sort of feedback that we really need more bandwidth coming back and this sort of thing, that they'll take that into account in the next generations. In other words, is it something that they're expecting to get for free, and as long as it works for doing games, they don't care about the rest, or are they seeing this as more in the future?
Yeah, I think that was the old model, is that game developers were the ones who were really digging into the details of how to extract every bit of computational power out of the graphics card.
Right.
And now that people are more interested in doing, not only in academia, but for doing things like the physics accelerators and NVIDIA has the Tesla system now, which is basically a big box full of GPUs that you can buy with the idea of giving it to people who want to do lots of parallel computation instead of buying a Cray or something like that. So I think that I was in grad school at the time they gave it to me, and I think they wanted to get relatively cheap hardware in the hands of people who might play with it and come up with applications that would lead people to buy more graphics cards. Okay, thank you.